James. And so we're going to open our books to James chapter 3, our Bibles to James chapter 3. And Riley White's going to read the scripture passages for us this morning.
Children's worship?
Children's worship, of course. Why didn't I say anything, Senator? Children's worship. If you go to children's worship, they got something amazing for you. And by the way, if you're visiting kindergarten through the first grade. So if you keep your finger in James, we're also going to start with 2 Chronicles chapter 1.
All right, so the first passage I'm going to read is from 2 Chronicles 1, verses 7 through 10. And that is on page 453 of your pew Bible. That night, God appeared to Solomon and said to him, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." Solomon answered, "God, you have shown great kindness to David my father and have made me king in his place. Now, Lord God, let your promise to my father David be confirmed. For you have made me king over a people who are as numerous as the dust of the earth. Give me wisdom and knowledge that I may lead this people, who is able to govern this great people of yours." And the New Testament passage is James 3, verses 13 through 18. And that is on page 1268. "Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, of the devil. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness." This is the word of the Lord.
So we're going to talk about wisdom to make peace. Peacemaking wisdom, if you will. It's easy to remember to forget, I guess, on Sunday morning that the world isn't full of peace. But it strikes me as I start talking this morning, there's a bit of urgency to this message. Jeanette just shared that in Detroit, her nephew was just shot and killed this morning, riding his bicycle. And first of all, I want to pray for Jeanette and her family because it's the third child that's lost, and obviously, even if it's first, it's really difficult. When I think about this message, it strikes me that there's so much, well, not peace in the world. And it's the message about wisdom, it's the message about how to live our lives in a path of wisdom. But really, in the end, it's a message about how to bring peace into this world. And that's the focus, and that's why it's so, so needed. So we'll start with wisdom. We'll start with this theme of wisdom and how to get it. I have this stage up here because it represents, for me anyway, well, first, second, third. I set this up with Elias yesterday, and he's like, "Oh, it's like first, second, third, right? It's instantly recognizable as the prize." So I want to use this morning to talk about the three stages of wisdom. And the first, third place is not knowing. You can get through life not knowing, you can get through life being ignorant, but it's not really the preferable way. You know, no one really wants to go into a race and get third place. You can do it, but that's not what you want to do. So that's not knowing. Second place is knowledge. And we know that knowledge isn't wisdom, but knowledge is required for wisdom, because if you don't have any knowledge, you're not going to be able to figure out what to do. And of course, first place in the passage for Solomon and for James is true wisdom. And that's the goal we're going through this morning. Now, I had an interesting experience this week. I went to the Secretary of State, and you know what the Secretary of State's like, right? You have to go there if you get certain things done. I needed to move title from one vehicle to another. And there's just no avoiding. You can't go to another branch, or I guess you can go to Hudsonville, that's pretty good. But you can't go to another competing agency, right? You have to go there. But I figured out something recently, and I have it posted right there. If you download an app on your phone called Q-List, not Clueless, Q-List, you can get on your phone app and say, I'd like to be seen in this category, and I'd like to be the next in line, or you can set a particular time. So I'm at home, I know I need to go there, I do this, and it says about an hour and 15 minutes. So I do a bunch of other stuff, and eventually show up at the Secretary of State about an hour and a half later. I just missed my place in line, but then I got a text that said this. It says, you missed your place in line. To rejoin the queue, press J, or send the letter J back to whatever thing this is. And so I'm sitting there in the Secretary of State, and I press J, and I'm waiting for it to go through, because my cell phone reception isn't very good in the Secretary of State. And finally it goes through, and I go, okay, I'm looking at the screen up there. And sure enough, at the top of the line in my category, it says 7994, which is my phone number. So I'm thinking, that's amazing. The room, by the way, is full of people. There's about 30 people in that line. I sit down very quietly because I don't want people to notice that I just walked in and now I'm going to get to the line. But I knew it was going to happen. This is a pretty good idea. I sit down, about maybe 10 seconds later, it goes, bing, now serving 7994 at window 4. You're going to quietly, non-exuberantly, so they don't want to get in trouble. Go up to the line and say, I'm here to get a title or a plate transfer from one vehicle to another. And it took like a few minutes, it cost $8. And it was just an amazing experience. It took about maybe 3 minutes, but often takes about an hour to get done. And I walked out of the line there and I thought to myself, something I don't really think of very often, but I looked around at all those people there. And I realized, I think I know something that nobody else here knows, right? Kind of a weird experience. It was especially a weird experience for me because in high school and college, I had quite the opposite experience rather often. So many times in particular classes, especially in math. I'm good at math, but not in class. I need about twice as many explanations as most people, so I just can't keep up in a classroom of math. Anybody with me here? Oh, thank you. Thank you. All you smart people, bless you, but I'm not with you. So I look around, I remember a guy named Kent who was a math whiz, and a girl named Missy who was just good at everything. And then she was later in a communications class in college with me. And I'm looking at these people so often in high school and grade school, later in college, thinking, these people just know something that I fundamentally do not know. And I don't know what it is, right? I'm studying, I'm learning, but I come up to a test and I get C's and they get A pluses, or I get D's and they get A's. Like, I don't know something they know. And maybe that's why when I was young and I'm reading through the Bible, I came across this passage in 2 Chronicles where Solomon, as a young man, not really young, he's probably 35 or 40, but as a relatively young man, inherits the kingdom of his father, which is the greatest kingdom in the whole ancient world at that time. He has to build a temple that his father had been preparing for. Everything's ready, but he has to build it. He has all the responsibilities, and he prays for wisdom, and God says, I will give you wisdom, right? So I'm reading that passage, I'm thinking, well, this is a great biblical prayer. I'm going to pray for wisdom. So there, I think about 14 or 15, and God, please, above anything else, I pray for wisdom. And notice the passage says knowledge, and I pray for that, but Lord, I want to be wise. And you pray that a few times, and that's not a bad prayer. We should all pray it. But it didn't take too long. I realized I wasn't going to be Solomon 2.0, right? I wasn't going to be the next great Solomon because I just didn't have that natural, inherent wisdom. But the passage itself is great. And then as I looked into this in the last week or two, I realized that wisdom really goes a lot deeper and is expressed in a lot of different ways than I thought of back then. So I want to share with some of that. I want to show all of you some of that this morning. I think you know what I'm trying to say. Some wisdom. I have not arrived yet, but I want to share some wisdom with you about this morning. So there's three stages, and we're going to start in James with the first stage, which is being, well, ignorant. I had a pastor friend who always talked about ignorance, and you've got to fight against ignorance, so that's what I'm going to do this morning. In the book of James, in verse 14, it defines ignorance. If you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, don't boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, of the devil. Where you find envy and selfish ambition, you find disorder and every evil practice. So what is ignorance? What is not knowing? What is not wisdom, according to the book of James? It says it's bitter envy and selfish ambition, and it results in disorder and every evil practice. That's what lack of wisdom results in, according to James. Now, it's particularly ungodly wisdom, but that's what James is talking about. That's ignorance. Now, I have a bit of a dilemma this morning, because I don't look out at you and see a bunch of bitterly envious and proudly boastful and massively disorderly people. And if you are that, you're hiding it really, really, really well. So, congratulations. But I really don't think that that's the main thing. I don't think of anybody in church who's full of bitter envy and selfish ambition. If you were, you probably wouldn't be here. You'd probably be working or doing something on Sunday morning. But as I thought about this for myself, I thought, well, what is something we struggle with in the church? What is something? And then my mind eventually went to irritation. How many of you get irritated during the week? You know, someone said the longest 5 seconds in the world is when the light ahead of you turns green and the car in front of you doesn't go. Or when someone in your family does something that, you know, you told them 1,000 times you don't like it, but they do it anyway. Or people in your family just don't get it, they start acting a certain way, and they just keep acting and keep acting and keep acting. People just get on our nerves all the time. And the root of it, I really think, is selfishness. I want them to act like I want them to act. Or I want them to act like me. I want them to stop impinging upon my comfort, my train of thought, my focus. And honestly, as I thought about this, I'm not always irritated. I try not to be irritated with y'all in church. But I get irritated sometimes. I not only don't have a lot of selfish ambition, but irritation? Guilty as charged. And what the text says is this. He says that doesn't... Well, another text says it doesn't result in the righteous life God desires. Anger, irritation doesn't result in that. To the extent that we get into this, it brings disorder and chaos of every kind. That's what the text says. That's what this is. That's being ignorant. We may be wise and all sorts of things, but if we act like that, that's what it brings. There's a passage in Revelation that I referred to once in a while that says this. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before God day and night and throw it down. Well, who is it? That's the enemy. What the enemy's job is he accuses us to God all the time. And when we get irritated, we get frustrated at the people who we're in a relationship with, who we're in the family of God with, and we start saying, well, I wish they wouldn't do this, if they just didn't do that, if they would act differently, what we're really doing is we're taking on the role of the enemy and accusing our brothers and sisters. And that's not what we want to do. It makes the enemy happy, and now you're doing my work. That's thrilling. That's ignorance. That's not what we're called to do. So obviously, we know that. Maybe that would be helpful to be convicted of during the week. So moving on to knowledge. We need knowledge, and knowledge brings us things that we didn't have before. Trying to figure out what I meant to say here. Sort of ironic, right? About knowledge. Alright, so what is wisdom according to the text? Well, wisdom is based upon knowledge and it goes to wisdom. James says this, who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. So how do we recognize true wisdom? Well, this comes up in my mind every once in a while. If you want to know if someone is truly following Jesus Christ, if they're truly empowered by the Spirit to do things of God, you don't sort of have to evaluate what they believe. You can just look at fruit. If someone is bearing good fruit, if the activities and actions in their lives are bearing good fruit, then you know that the Spirit of God is active and living in their life. That they're not living this sort of ignorant, selfish life. That there's knowledge and there's wisdom and something good is happening somewhere. Do they have the fruit of the Spirit? Is there love, joy, peace, patience, kindness? Is their activities, their actions, and their faith combined in their lives so they can act like Jesus Christ and things are happening in their lives that could not happen any other way? By their fruit, the Bible says, you shall know them. Sorry, and that's what the passage says here. Who is wise and understanding among you? Judge by their good fruit. And it says, this passage here, says this, but the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy, and good fruit, impartial, and sincere. So that's what results in. Now I have another level here that I want to talk about, but before we get there, I want to ask this. Is your life resulting in those things that I just read? In good things? When I think about that, some of us have areas of our lives that are full of chaos and disorder and discord. It might not be every area. But maybe you find when you get online, there's always this about certain things. Or maybe there's other areas of your life, your finances are a mess, or your relationships with someone in your life is a mess. And what the passage says, if you sow seeds of peace, you raise a harvest of righteousness. And some of us have a whole lot of harvest of chaos and disorder in our lives. And we think, well, why is that? I believe, I follow Jesus Christ, what is this? Well, you're sowing seeds of peace. Because the text says, when you sow seeds of peace, you raise a harvest of righteousness. That's how it works. And if you're not raising a harvest of righteousness, if there's chaos, if there's disorder, if you find yourself arguing about things in your life, and you really think, why am I arguing about this? Maybe it's partly in your court that you're not sowing seeds of peace. The end of this text here is really where I want to end up, because it talks about peacemakers. In the end of this verse here, in James 3, verse 18, it talks about peacemakers. Peacemakers who sow in peace, raise a harvest of righteousness. So these are really the stages. And this is what I want to focus on. So there's ignorance. Third place, you don't want to end up in third place most of your life, there's ignorance. And then there's knowledge. And you can live a life of knowledge and know a lot of stuff but really not have wisdom. You can sow a harvest of unrighteousness and, know a lot of stuff, but really you don't have this kind of wisdom that James is talking about. And then there's wisdom, where you take knowledge and you know knowledge, but then you can apply it in a very particular context and apply it in a very particular way. And that's really what I realized this week in a new way what wisdom is. Wisdom is taking all of your experiences and applying it in a very particular context, right? Wisdom is so contextual. I was at my tax person this Friday, right in the back of the Fortune magazine that I paged through real quickly. Leah Iacocca, who was the old CEO of Chrysler, said, even a good decision made at the wrong time, made too late, isn't the course of wisdom. Wisdom is making the right decision at the right time for the right reason. That's what wisdom is. It's taking knowledge and making it in the right time. And when we do that at exactly the right time, we get a harvest of righteousness. Now, what I realized this week is this about peacemaking. You can have someone who's wise, but then there's yet another level above us. I'm not sure this is wise per se here. But there is another level above it. And I think as we get into the word peacemaking, I begin to understand what this is. Years ago, I memorized the Beatitudes. And the Beatitudes are a passage in Matthew chapter 5, and it says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the earth. And every type of person that's called blessed is a very particular blessing they receive. So here's a few of them in case you haven't heard them. Blessed are those who mourn, they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. And I read through this, I heard a lot of them before, but then the one toward the end here says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. And I thought about that for probably a couple weeks. Why are peacemakers called sons of God? Why aren't they called something else? Why is that the blessing they receive? It took a while, and it involved a lot of passages that I don't have the time to share this morning, but what I eventually realized is peace is exactly what Jesus came to bring. He came to bring peace between God and man. He came to bring peace between us here. We live in peace because of the influence of Christianity on our culture. He came to bring peace between brothers and sisters. He came to bring peace on earth in ways that no one else could. So when we're peacemakers, when we bring wisdom in a particular context, we're acting like Jesus, and we're identifying with the Son of God. And the text says we become sons of God because we're acting like the Son of God. We're living in Christ, like I prayed about earlier. So we can be wise, there's lots of wise people all over the world, there's lots of people with the gift of wisdom, but when we get away from ignorance, when we get knowledge, when we get wisdom, and then begin to apply that in a way that brings peace, then we get even higher. Now this looks kind of dangerous, doesn't it? Some of you are thinking, hey, keep his balance, and my wife will tell you, yeah, I always keep my balance, so don't worry about it. If I fall, this is starting to be over and you get to go home. But this is really what James is talking about. He's talking about going beyond ignorance, beyond knowledge, beyond wisdom, to your true calling. And that, as a matter of fact, is a little bit dangerous. Because if you advance into a role in your circle of friends, whether it's in the fifth grade or college or in your business setting or in a small group, what you become is to become a leader. And being a leader elevates you to a certain extent above where you were before. And it's dangerous, it's risky, because people are asking you to speak in their lives. You're thinking, really? I'm supposed to speak in their lives? I can barely keep track of my own life. I'm like, what am I supposed to be doing? Well, being wise, being a peacemaker, involves risk. And some of us are so hesitant to step into it, but actually that's what God is calling you to do. To allow yourself and your gifts and your fruit to speak into the lives of the people around you so you can truly be a peacemaker. One of the roles as a pastor, and one of your roles as elders and members, is to continually speak into the life of the church in such a way that it brings peace. One of my main roles here at church is to strike a balance between asking you, as the people of God, to move forward in the ministry that God has called us to go into boldly and without reservation and advance the kingdom of God here in this place and then do things in ways that we've never done before for the sake of the kingdom of God. Just like the story in the Bible and the scriptures, God is always asking people to do things they never did before. And that's what we're called to do here as a church, and I keep inviting you into that. And actually, many of you keep us inviting us into that too. But my other role is continually to be a peacemaker. To help the church, to help me avoid conflict. And those roles don't always suit each other so well. Because when you move forward, there's conflict, there's questions, we ask questions, but what we're called to do as a church is seek peace and bring peace in the midst of our lives and following Jesus Christ together. That's what we're called to do. That's what we're called to be as a church. Because when the church is divided, it can't do what it's called to do. That's risky. It's much easier to stay safe, and that's what Christians and churches are doing all over the world. But people don't come to Christ that way. It just becomes a church. Peacemaking wisdom, by the grace of God, is how we're called to go forward as a church. I'm going to get off of this and tell you a little bit about James. Because James... James was a guy who you might remember didn't start off as a believer in Jesus Christ. Even though James was the brother of Jesus, he did believe in Jesus, being the Son of God. He actually encouraged Jesus to go down to Jerusalem and sort of get himself in a dangerous situation where he might be killed because they didn't believe him. Then later, you might remember, after the resurrection, Jesus met with James, and James at some point gave his life to Jesus Christ. And in the beginning of the book of James, he says, James, that identifies himself, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And now, here in this book, he's writing to people about how to follow Jesus. What you may not know is how James eventually died and the story associated with that. And this is sort of broad outlines of the story from the church historian, the Jewish historian Josephus. James lived in Jerusalem pretty much till the end of his life. All the other apostles sort of scattered and did things other places, but James stayed there till the end of his life, at which point he was eventually killed by the Pharisees. But at one point toward the end of his life, there was a conflict in Jerusalem about Jesus. And James had so much respect by the Christians, by the Jewish people, by the Pharisees, and by the people who ruled that area that they called them to sort of adjudicate, to have to speak wisdom into a particular context at that time. Everybody respected him. Everybody. because he exemplified this kind of peacemaking wisdom. Now, he wasn't fuzzy about Jesus Christ that eventually would got him killed, but he exemplified this way of peacemaking wisdom, even though he was a leader of the church, advancing the church forward, helping them to do what they were called to do. That's who James was. And here in this passage, he says, look, there's all sorts of things you can do, but seek wisdom from heaven. Because any other kind of wisdom isn't from heaven. So what do we do with this here in our lives today? And I think there's three applications that I want to go for. One of them, which is this, a simple encouragement. Many of you have been walking with God for a long time, and if I talk about how to get wisdom from God, you say, yeah, that's so true. In so many different situations, I've asked God for wisdom, and he's given it to me, and that's just such a blessing. I look out and I see those of you, so many, pretty much all of you that I can think of, just have this experience where you're constantly asking God for wisdom, and he's granting you wisdom that you would never get any other way. So if that's the case, go home encouraged that God is the source of all wisdom. Most of us, myself, there's always one or two areas of life where we need wisdom, where we simply don't know what to do. And what James says here is that when we go to God, he gives us wisdom from heaven to bring peace. And when we sow in peace, we raise a harvest of righteousness. Some of us here maybe need to ask Jesus into our lives for the first time. We've been living a certain way, and our lives have resulted in anything but peace. Everything gets stripped away. Now, we need to invite Jesus in. Have him speak to us, have him equip us, so we in turn can help other people. I don't know where you're at this morning, but wisdom is available from God. We don't have all the wisdom in our heart, but wisdom is available. So when I was first in ministry, I got to know someone who gave me a great prayer. And the prayer is, Father, forgive me. I'm lost in this jungle. I'm lost, and I want to be free. And for me, it was just a great, simple prayer about asking for forgiveness, asking for empowerment. And the prayer came from my friend, Michi, who's here this morning. So I'd like to invite you to come up. And we'll just talk this off, see how this happens. So Michi and I know each other for what, 14, 15 years, somewhere? And I don't even know what to say, but I don't know, where did we meet? Remember?
We met on Bates Street.
Yeah. I think we're sisters in business, right?
Yep.
And we got to know each other, and then I was working for a church, I really didn't know what I was doing. And Michi didn't know what he was doing in some ways, but the police got onto him, and he ended up in a Kent County jail. And they let me come see you, and we talked to each other, I think, just in the room, and then we ended up, you got thrown in a little separate private room.
Right.
Private quarters.
Got a little trouble.
And the amazing thing is they let us talk to each other through the food slot. And so I was sitting down, and you were sitting on the other, and we were talking through the food slot. And I don't know why, but they let us talk for a long time. And This is kind of, so Michi can rap really very well.
So can Mark.
Oh yeah. You don't want to hear like rap. So he shared these things with me, and this really spoke to me because it really, we're in different contexts, we come out of different worlds, but the prayer spoke to me because he in his context was looking for wisdom, for forgiveness, for empowerment, and I was doing the exact same thing as a new person looking for a church. I was like, I don't know what I need, but God, I need something more. And I think this prayer really spoke to both of us. So really, Rab, a spoken word should have maybe music behind it, some turntables. But I wanted you to hear this raw, like I heard it. And so we're just going to spit this for us and then share it.
Lord, let the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. Our rock and our redeemer. Father, forgive me. I'm lost in this jungle. I'm waiting for you to save me. Father, forgive me. I'm lost and I want to be free. Father, forgive me. I'm lost in this jungle. Waiting for you to save me. Father, forgive me, I'm lost and I want to be free. So many tribes, thinking is it all worthwhile? I'm left stranded at the knot, not knowing who to run to. My mentality grew for the different crowds that I drew. Living life through rhymes that I write. I spent short days and long nights with no hope to keep the mental flow. A lack of mental growth, the humble breath in my soul. Visual distractions kept the mental reacting. No type of principles, living critical, man. Half a good man, but a criminal, man. Life rotates like ceiling fans on dry desert sands. But I still feel heat tension, bending my knees in the begging position. Eyes closed, hands full, screaming for my freedom. Yo, God save my soul, cause I'm tired of these demons. Create again, a free man, free being. I can't stay strong forever. I put my heart on papers and ask God for a favor. Back then, I never knew God could do if I asked him. Never knew about my spiritual till I tapped in. Now I'm astral plane, brain mineral game. Rebuking Satan's den for better days in heaven. Father, forgive me. I'm lost in this journey. I'm waiting for you to save me, save me. Father, forgive me. I'm lost and I want to be free.
In the book of Colossians, this passage, it was given to a church that was in a context where they're always seeking mysteries and secret knowledge and things that were sort of esoteric and unknown. And the writer of Colossians cuts through all that and says, this is the source of all wisdom. You want to know what wisdom is? It's in Jesus Christ. And he wrote this. It says, Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things on heaven, things in earth, and things on things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that everything he might have is supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. And I love that passage. It says, God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. And sometimes you think, why Jesus? Why Jesus? Why did God put Jesus here? Why are we saved through Jesus Christ? Why does it have to be Jesus? He says, it don't have to be Jesus, but it is. Because God was pleased. You think, why was God pleased? I don't know. Why were you pleased he waited for breakfast this morning? God did it. The point is that God, for some reason, was pleased to have all the fullness of the heavenly being dwell in human form in Jesus Christ. He presented himself to us in Jesus Christ so we could have access to God the Father and all his eternal wisdom through Jesus Christ. And all we got to do is ask. All we got to do is ask. And so let's ask. Father, forgive us. Because all too often we are lost in this jungle. And we want to be free. It might just be one area, Father. It might just be one little area we can't figure out. Father, we pray for forgiveness in that area. Can you speak to us and set us free? Rip us apart from our sins so we could live free and live empowered to live as you called us to live, Father. It might be everything, Father. Could you forgive us and set us free? We want to be free to serve you. Father, I pray that anybody who has any particular challenge this morning, that you speak to us and give us wisdom, whether it's wisdom for prayer, wisdom for how to deal with loss in our family, wisdom for how to make a decision, wisdom how to get out of homelessness, wisdom how to get into or out of functional relationships. Father, I pray that you give us wisdom. And Father, for all the things you've done, for the ways you've empowered us over the years, I thank you. I thank you that we are not what we once were. I thank you that we're on a journey, that you're empowering us, that you're setting us free, that you're equipping us to be who you called us to be. I thank you that you're equipping us and calling us in to be part of a bigger story than ourselves. I pray that in the power of the Spirit, you'll lead us forward. and help us to be who we are called to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.